So, hello, I am Martin. I'm CEO and co-founder of the smartcredit.io. And we are doing free webinars. We are actually trying once a week. So at the moment we schedule it always for the Sundays. Perhaps we have to find another slot which fits better the people's schedules. Today I will speak about the coronavirus market crisis. Where to invest? Let's assume we have $5,000 to invest. Where to invest it? Okay. So let's speak a short agenda. We try to compress everything in max 50 minutes. Let's keep effective. We look first what is happening on the markets. The second is what we are looking. Why is this happening on the markets? And the third one is we are looking where to invest. Like what are the investment opportunities? And then these are first 3 parts. They should take like let's say 35 minutes to 40 minutes. And then we have last parts, questions, answers. So you can submit questions and answers. Okay, I will submit answers. You submit questions. Then via the chat. Of course, you can use the chat in the meantime as well, because this will make it easier to run this webinar. Okay, then let's get started. What is happening on the markets? Okay, this is our Standard & Poor's index, Standard & Poor's 500, and it's quite a long time period. So we are looking from 2009 till 2020 till now. So the upper part we see the price action, the price movements, and the lower part is just an RSI index. Now we've seen that since Lehman crisis at the bottom was end of 2008, beginning 2009, we have moved up on the S&P quite a lot from 668 to 3 to 3,000. 300 something, and it came down. Now, obviously, what we are seeing now is that several people are saying, okay, it came down, now it's the time to buy. So, and the question is it really so? Is this now the time to buy? Maybe it's not. So, and we have first, before doing these decisions, we just need to analyze what is happening with the markets. Let's look a little bit more statistics. These are the returns on the main asset classes. So we see multiple asset classes here, like on the bottom, like a crude oil, Ethereum, Bitcoin, Dow Jones, and on the end we see the gold. And we see practically all asset classes have been falling, except one, and this is the gold. Now, some people, because we are in the cryptosphere, some people are surprised that that as well the Bitcoin was falling like 30% or 23%, 25% during this time. We wrote one blog article about this, why this happened. But the short explanation is it was run into the it was just run into the cash, and any assets were sold. Any assets were sold just run into the cash, including the Bitcoin. Now, but it's important just to see that practically all assets except gold have been falling. Okay, so this is one data point. Now let's move forward and let's look here. These are the US jobless claims. It is actually from the last week, not from the last week, the week before this week. So we see the history of these jobless claims. These are weekly claims in the US. And we see these red bars. Now, the red bars, these are the places where we had the recessions. So we see the jobless claims are going up. We have a recession. Jobless claims are going down. The economy is running. And this is what happened now 1 week ago. It's unprecedented. It was weekly 3 million jobless claims in the United States. And this is what happened this week's 6 point something million jobless claims came additionally. So that means technically speaking, US is in a recession already. Not only the US, it's practically all world has entered the recession. So, and for the people who love like a data points, there is as well a PMI index. It's a purchase manager index. Okay, this is quite a lagging indicator. So we see this for France, for Italy, for German, for Spain. But it analyzes the mood of the of the purchasers. And we see this mood, the orders that have gone went significantly down on the recession level worldwide. And because it's a lagging indicator, the real values of this one are much more down. So now let's think, where are we on the coronavirus phase? Okay, it's a chart with JP Morgan. It's a very valuable chart. And we have here different states, different states which are putting on one slide. We see India is in early development. The UK and US are in the acceleration phase. The Italy is getting accumulation. So accumulation means that the growth starts to decline. And then we have recovery phase when the numbers are starting then to go down. The China is in the recovery phase. But what we have to see in this graph, in China, it has taken like 3 months to get to the recovery phase. So we can expect at least the same for any other country here on this chart. So it's not something here that is just going fast down and coming fast up, but we have rather a situation. It goes down, it stays down, and it's getting restarted. So what we are seeing is that the economy is put on the hold, and then in 2 months from now, maybe in 3 months from now, the economy will be restarted. Now, in just 2 to 3 months, there will be massive damage done then to the economy. And then the impact of this, we will see it later. So how will this crisis play out? So this crisis can be called on multiple different versions. Like one is that we can call it, it's a deflationary crisis. It can be inflationary crisis. Crisis of the bank failures, it can be monetary reset crisis. So, but actually these are the phases. These are the phases of this crisis, how this crisis will play out. And we are at the moment in the first phase. This is the phase where the revenues are declining. So, because we have massive supply shock, the supply is not coming. Let's think that the factories, yeah, this just-in-time production lines, the factories which are producing just-in-time, they cannot produce because the suppliers are not delivering. And because these factories who want to produce just-in-time cannot produce, then they cannot demand from the other suppliers. It's enough for one supplier to fail to stop these factories which are dependent. So supply shock transfers to the demand shock. Demand is declining and we get into deflationary economy. What is the response on this deflationary economy? It's the standard response. It's initial base migration. Now, but the initial base migration, it has been massive. Let's think that in last 40 years, usually the base migration per year has been like 12%. The base money is a central banking money, which has been created per year. Now, in a very short term, very short time, the Federal Reserve has now extended balance sheet massively, much more. So we have massive base money extension. And we also have massive stimulus packages from the nations. Okay, and this will lead to the second phase. The second phase is that, let's face it, the most of, not the most part of economy, but quite a part of economy are, these are the zombie companies. These are the companies which can exist only in the low interest rate environment. And this low interest rate environment, this is bringing the situation where the companies, which in the usual environment could not exist, they can just continue. However, this situation where we are running now will bring with us with it a credit crunch. That means banks start to lend less. Banks lending less will bring the zombies down. Zombies defaulting on the loans. Now, and this will create a fear in the banks, and the banks will increase the credit spreads. Increasing credit spreads means the more zombies defaulting. And this, what is the next? And the banks start to take losses. But the losses are so big, the banks also start to take these losses as well on their equity capital. So we are running into credit crunch, where banks start to lend less and less. The zombie companies are failing, and the response on this one will be massive base migration. And we see now the Federal Reserve has now just in 2-3 months included the balance sheet by 150%. This is probably what will continue. So in the second phase, the massive base migration. And this will lead us to the next phase. That is the bank failures. Now, the syndromes here are the bail-ins. The bail-in are these laws that were introduced like 2012, 2013. It means that the money of the depositors, meaning people like you and me, will be converted to the equity of the banks. Now, obviously the equity of these banks doesn't have any value. So you will not have your deposits anymore. You have shares of the bank. But the bank is practically doesn't have any value and you can sell the share at very low price. Practically, you're just losing your deposits. The other is a bailout. The bailout means the government and Federal Reserves are doing this. No, but for central banks. But for central banks to do this, they have to print even more money. And for governments to do it, they have to borrow money. But they have been over borrowing already, so it will be quite tough for them to borrow. Meaning the main response will be even more base migration. Now, but in the same time, the zombies will continue on defaulting. And this will lead them to even more losses on the banks. And then we'll get onto this, the nationalization of the banks and nationalization of the pension funds in the countries where they are not public pension funds, but like some European countries, they are rather private pension funds. Okay. And all of this will be accompanied by a massive monetary expansion, meaning creating additional base money. And then it's quite possible when we're getting to phase three of the bank failures that we get as well into phase four of the monetary reset. There will no trust in the monetary system, hyperinflation. Why hyperinflation? Because there will be so much new money printed, so much new central bank money. Let's think historically it has been 12% per year, but now in some months we will have it like 50 to 100% per year, just starting with this. So the monetary reset means as well that the gold and BTC or Bitcoin will skyrocket. Now, and the response to the monetary reset will be probably new gold-based base money, because central banks own a lot of gold. They will use this gold then to create a new base money. And this will be either national or supranational, and this will be created. Now, monetary reset means as well that most of people, especially middle class, will lose their assets. The people below the middle class anyhow will not have any assets. Middle class will lose the assets. So we're speaking of the upper 5%, a little bit less, who can keep the assets. So it's not wealth growth, it's a wealth preservation. That is now important in these scenarios. And because we see that this response has so massive money printing, then we are not speaking here of this crisis as just a supply shock or demand shock or deflationary economy. This is a monetary crisis. And if you're speaking where to invest, these are as well the responses like where to invest during the monetary crisis. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Okay, now let's walk just by the topics. Okay, because we have standard asset classes, stocks, bonds, we have real estate. Okay, it's not listed here. And then we have monetary assets, and we have equities, like private equity. Let's go one by one through them, and let's look at them. Now, buy stocks. If your bank is telling you you should buy stocks, well, now all recommendations just to tell the bank to wait. Because these are now on the left you see the chart how much the stock exchanges have been declining on the major crisis. Like this was the 29 crisis, 1929 crisis. We have 87 crisis, 2000 crisis, 2008. And now in a corona crash, we are just 25%, 27% true. Okay, so there's a way to go. The second question is now, okay, what's the duration of the crisis? Okay, we looked before that it will take 2 to 3 months that the economy will be on hold. because it will just take these 2 to 3 months to get to these phases, which are burning and through the virus. But that means that the revenues will be declining all these 2 to 3 months, and declining revenues mean declining stock price, means the stock price is going down, and so on and so on. So it's too early to buy the stocks. Now, on the second chart, we had this S&P with the Fibonacci levels, and by Fibonacci levels, we see at least the S&P is going down at least to 1700, now maybe to 1250. Means the decline will continue. Just from simple reason, the revenues are disappearing, companies cannot produce, the companies are highly over leveraged. These are like the companies which focused early on the production, take a typical production company, Boeing or so, have become all over leveraged financial companies that depending on the credit markets, they need to have a certain value of revenues to keep going because the leverage cost is so high now. But they cannot keep these revenues. They cannot keep this leverage. So the stock will be falling. And then let's see, maybe some of these companies will even get nationalized, not only the bank, but as well airlines, utility companies, and the others. So it's too early for the stocks. Now let's look on the next one, buy bonds. Well, if your bank is telling you to buy bonds, well, tell them no. Just a simple word, no. There's a kind of picture like how this crisis will play out, the phases of this crisis. This is a monetary crisis. This is a monetary crisis where we have first deflationary economy, then inflationary economy. The credit spreads will go up. That means the bond prices will just collapse. Now, the only bonds which will not be collapsed are the US treasuries. Then let's take the short-term bills, that means below the 12 months, because the people, the investors probably will take the cash out of the banks because banks will not be trustworthy. And this money from the banks, which is in the banks, is rather deposited into the treasuries because treasuries are much more secure than any bank in the world. So except treasuries, US government treasuries, buy bonds, simple answer, no. Okay, now, so that's remaining. What do we do with this $5,000? And there is the answer. Buy monetary assets. Now, this crisis, when it started, let's think again. The only asset which didn't decline was on gold. So, because it's a monetary crisis. So, it means gold. And as well, gold and silver to go together. Now, they try to a little bit to tell the people that silver is just an industrial metal. This is not true. Silver has been monetary assets for thousands of years as well. So therefore as well, physical silver is something that is recommended. And then of course, crypto, Bitcoin, Ethereum. It's the monetary assets of the cryptosphere where you control the keys. But the keys cannot be, you control the keys and the supply cannot be manipulated. We see later a chart about the supply growth from the central banks. But that's it. So Bitcoin, Ethereum, then supply is given, cannot be manipulated, and you have to control the keys of these crypto assets. Meaning don't use third party exchanges, use your own keys. Buy monetary assets. Now let's look a little bit more in detail. So this is one nice chart. It's a currency priced in gold. So that means we look, we don't look in a price of gold, we don't look how much was gold, what's the price of gold, we look the opposite, what's the price of fiat in gold. So, and this is, it's the graph is from beginning of 1970, and we see this major US currencies, major currencies, US dollar, euro, British pound, Japanese yen, or is it the Swiss franc? It doesn't matter. All of them have been declining. Now, if you are running the monetary crisis, then the gold, which has been a base money for the last 5,000 years, except now the phase where from 1971, where the gold was decoupled from the fiat money, The gold has been always a monetary asset till 1971, and not then anymore. So why has this happened from 1971 till now? Okay, and here we have this one little chart. There is one little very good website where we can get this monetary data. Now, what is this chart showing? It's a worldwide base money. That means central banking money growth since 1971. Yearly growth. It's not only Federal Reserve, it's as well Swiss National Bank, okay, ECB, when ECB was created, or German Bundesbank, all of them. So you take total amount of base money worldwide, and you look how much it has been growing year by year. And you get an average 12% yearly. 12% base money expansion. Now, and this is what central banks are doing. They're answering to any crisis that there is, the same recipe. This create more money, create more base money at 12% per year. That's why gold price has went up, and that's why gold price will go up even more significantly. And now let's look on one more chart here. Okay, this is a fiat money depreciation since 1900. And we have here, okay, that's the previous chart. This here from the middle of the, where we have the red arrow. Here is the previous chart. But we see as well, most of other currencies, all of them have disappeared. So this yellow line here, this is the gold, and all other lines, there have been German mark, Reichsmark, Deutschmark, there was a European currency unit, all of them. So all of them have been declining, declining, declining. Why? Because it's a monetary expansion by the central banks. So which Fed protects from this is these are the monetary assets which cannot be controlled. These are again gold, silver, Bitcoin, Ethereum. Okay, maybe Litecoin. So these are more the cryptocurrencies, say, which you can classify as the monetary assets. Okay, let's move on. Oh, so 5-10 more minutes. So then let's think as well now in the decoupled industries. Okay, so agriculture. The food shortages are coming. Let's look in Europe. People are supposed to work on the fields, but they are in the lockdown. They cannot go to work on the fields. Now the spring is coming back next year. Spring is not coming back this year. So food shortages are coming. So that means the land prices are going up, and as well the land production, the enterprises on the land, their price will go up as well. As well, decoupled industries. Let's think the industries which don't depend on the physical presence or physical location. Of course, we have crypto, that's on the next slide. But it's like a virtual reality, gaming, VPN providers, 3D. So this is where we don't depend on the location. And so location independent, decoupled industries. So this is, let's say it more traditional industries, but any other, so stocks and so probably they have like a one way. Why? Because of declining revenues, because of the increasing credit spreads, and just declining revenue and increasing credit spread means the stock prices will tank. So as simple it is. Now, and the next one is then the buy blockchain based alternative finance. Opportunities. Because continuous debasement, continuous monetary debasement that we have seen, that we will see again now in the next months. Let's think again what the Federal Reserve did. Federal Reserve balance sheet was $4 trillion. $4 trillion. Now, as a first response to the coronavirus, they declared that they will increase the balance sheet by $2.2 trillion. After doing this, they announced now this $4 trillion extension. And not only that it's a $4 trillion extension, so it is as well unlimited extension. So it's a continuous unlimited extension. This is a continuous debasement. debasement of debasement of the Federal Reserve, from the Federal Reserve, and more coming as well from the other central banks. So what does this mean? Okay, like we looked on the previous slides, this continuous debasement will result in the monetary reset. Now, the shock that we see in this economy, we looked on the previous slide, we had these four phases. The first phase, declining revenues. The second phase, zombie companies going down. And for us, it's clear we get to the second phase. Why? Because the shock is so strong. So we look at the unemployment records, we look at the PMI indexes, we looked at the lockdowns that go 2-3 months, and the virus is burned through the economies. And this will mean zombie companies running out of cash, running out of revenues. This is one part. Now the Federal Reserve tries to push in the cash, like every nation is trying to do this. But the other thing that is happening, the credit spreads are going up. Because of credit spreads are going up, the refinancing cost of these zombies are getting more and more bigger. And this will create holes to the banks. The banks will start to lend even less and less. When banks are lending less and less, then the credit spreads are even more increasing. This will bring down more zombie companies. And then we just get this natural cleaning where the zombie companies will disappear. Now, disappearing zombie companies are very healthy because since 2007, 2008 crisis, zillions of zombie companies have continued their existence only thanks to this super low quantitative easing terms. They would not be able to exist in the normal interest rate environment. What is normal interest rate? Okay, the inflation to say is like 1% or so. If you look on the shadow stats, which is using the same methods of inflation calculation which were used in the US before Clinton and the company changed them. So it was done in 1990s, the inflation calculation methods were changed. So then we are getting, by this pre-1990, we are actually getting 6%, like a 6% inflation. But if you're looking on the monetary expansion, so by the monetary expansion, the inflation should be around 10%, because we are seeing like worldwide monetary expansion, 12%, 12%. Okay, this is an average. So some year more, some year less. So the interest should be at least as much as the inflation. Now, going down to 6% or going to this 10% or higher means massive amount of these companies can just exist. So these are these zombie companies, the second phase. And we think this second phase will play through as well. The zombies will disappear. It's a very good cleaning effect of the market, of this 10 years of credit party. Other like a fiat money party, the credit money party, which has been created by the commercial banks. So it's good that the zombies will disappear, but disappearing zombies will take down the banks. And taking down the banks needs some massive money to recapitalize them. This money is missing. This money will be created again, again, and again. And this money creation will then result in inflation, massive inflation, which then will lead to the monetary reset. After every massive inflation, we have a monetary reset. And so that's what we're thinking. So, and that's what we are then thinking, what is our view is, because we are getting to the monetary reset, this the traditional banking financial industry, what we know so far, start to deteriorate. And we think the alternative finance, which is then independent from the current financial system, will start to prosper more and more. So the less trust will be there in the existing financial system, credit system and monetary system, the more trust the alternative financial system will win. And if you speak alternative financial system, we speak of blockchain-based alternative finance. Okay, now, this is then my last slide. Now to just to summarize, let's go to the key asset classes. Okay, stocks, no. Bonds, no. Okay, except the treasuries. Just take out money of the banks, put it on the treasuries. As well as private equity, definitely no, because it's highly over-leveraged. And now we're getting monetary assets. Yes, yes, it's a definitive yes, because it's required. Because crisis is a monetary crisis. Then the next decoupled industries, the traditional economical sector, so where we are location independent, so or we, where we provide services to these lockdown companies or individuals, and the last one, blockchain-based alternative finance. Oh, and I forgot to say, like monetary assets. It's a crypto, gold, and silver. Okay, now I'm finished with the slides. I finished the walkthrough. I will propose you ask the questions via the chat. And yes, then I will answer them one by one. Okay, I see the first question coming. How long will this, the question is, how long will this four phases take time? Okay, let's think now that, okay, what we see now is the massive fiscal stimulus, massive monetary stimulus. So how long does it take time? So, and this will, it, so this stimulus will just delay. It will delay what was naturally happening anyhow. They will just shoot out their powder, the gunpowder, they will destroy it instead of keeping it for later. Now, the first phase, the declining revenues. So we will see this for, let's say, 6 months. For 6 months, we see this declining revenues model. And then after 6 months from now, 6 to 12 months, then we start to see the zombie companies. We see the failures because the defaults, because they just cannot refinance the loans. They can exist only in the low interest rate. They want to refinance low interest rate, they cannot do it. They have take high interest rate, they're not capable to generate revenues to support these high interest rate loans. They will fail. So in 6 to 12 months. Now then, at, from 12 months, then it will start that banks, or maybe a little bit earlier, that the banks start to take losses. So from 12 months from now. So 12 to 18 months, banks start to take losses. This will bring down even more zombie companies. So going down. And then the response, because the response is a monetary expansion, then in 18 months or so from now, we will see this hyperinflation appearing. And in increasing hyperinflation, it will as well mean that we have a monetary reset. So that means the four phases in total 18 months. So 18 months or more. So we'll calculate like one phase, like 6 months. Now, the next question is, which companies will survive the crisis? Okay, let's separate two sectors. Let's look at the traditional economy, and then let's look at the crypto company. Now, traditional economies, the companies which are not overleveraged, that means which have little loans relative to the balance sheet, relative to their revenues, they can survive. The companies in a crypto companies, because crypto and the blockchain based alternative finance, this is a replacement. This will be the replacement for the traditional finance. And this will survive, and this could become, the more people will lose the trust in the existing financial system, the more it will gain. Okay, now let's see, the next question is, do you think we will have a situation with the food supply chain? Okay, let me add some data points here. Like Kazakhstan, okay, has stopped exports of the wheat. Now, Kazakhstan is one of the biggest wheat exporters worldwide, but they have stopped doing this. Now let's think on Spain, like it's a lockdown, so you have to stay at home. So who's working on the fields? Same in Italy, same in other South European countries. Let's think that, okay, it's not so much publicly said, but European economy, the agriculture, depends very much on the third state's labor. They are usually Ukrainian or other countries. Tunisia, Morocco. Now, this third state labor is not coming anymore to Europe. They have to leave, and no new visas are issued. So, it's not only that people are not working on the fields, the people who are should usually work on the fields, like 1,800,000 usually every year, the third state's labor, they're not there. They're not doing the work. So even if Europeans would work on the fields, there will not be enough people to do it. So yes, we will get a shortage on the supply chain. Okay, this means the food price starts to increase, it means the inflation, which cannot be hidden. And okay, the response will be the traditional response to this one. Okay, the package sizes or reduction of the assortment. Yes, but okay, I would not say a big problem, but this will be quite a challenge on the supply chain. Yes. Okay, any other questions? Next questions? Okay, then we continued with these seminars. We will do it with webinars. We'll do this like once a week. Okay, we choose the Sunday, like maybe a Sunday, maybe people are enjoying more the Sundays than other days. Maybe you have to put it another day, we have to discuss it. But the aim is that we will do it once a week. We will speak about the topic, what is happening now in the economy, traditional economy. We'll speak of the topic, what is happening in the crypto economy. And always we try to speak not so much about what is happening now, but what is happening as next. So we will record this, we recorded this seminar, and we'll put it on YouTube as well. We'll publish the link then on the on our Telegram and Twitter. These are two main channels. So very many thanks for listening. So stay tuned and feel free to ask questions on Twitter or on Telegram. So thank you. Thank you for listening.